So, perfect. So, can you upload? Are you going to use slides? Sharing your, I guess you should.
Yeah, I have slides. So they send it to you.
Can you actually be able to? Like, I'm sure if I have the rights to share your screen. Second.
Alex, I made you a co-host. You should be able to share your own screen.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Let me see. So
in the bottom there should be like in the center a green button.
Let's see.
That looks good. Yeah, it looks good.
Okay.
We still see the chat. Maybe you kind of close the chat. I can tell you whenever there is a question if you want in the chat.
Okay. Does this like go away? Can I hide this? Okay, well, I'll just put it down there. So
perfect. You want to have it looks good. You want to have the questions right at the beginning during your talk or at the end?
During the talk is fine.
During your talk is fine. Cool. Okay. Perfect. Looks good. Okay, so thank you, Alex. So the next talk is going to go on in the session of lambda terms, and we're going to hear from Alex about the distribution of parameters in certain fragments of the linear and planar lambda calculus. So thank you, Alex, and go ahead.
Thank you. So my name is Alex, Alexandros Singh, and I'm presenting you some joint work with Olivier Bodini and Noam Zeilberger. So let us start. So what is the lambda calculus? Well, I imagine like everybody already knows a bit about it, and the previous talk also illuminated some of the basic notions, but I'll just go over it again very fastly. So the lambda calculus is a universal formal system for expressing computation. It's universal in the sense that anything computable under some appropriate notion of computability is computable by the lambda calculus. So this means that anything computable by, for example, a universal Turing machine is also computable by a lambda term. And its terms are formed by the following simple grammar. We have that variables are valid terms. So we will have an infinite supply of variables, which we will denote by lowercase Latin letters. And if x is a variable and t is a valid term, then so is the abstraction formed as lambda x dot t. So we say the abstraction has variable x and the body t. And finally, if s and t are valid terms, then so is the application of s to t. Or I guess it's t to s, it's red t to s. So the lambda calculus also provides us with some tools to transform these terms. And the most important one, the most famous one also, is the notion of beta reduction. And what beta reduction does is it tells us how to reduce terms which look like the application of some argument or function. So if you have a lambda term, lambda xt, and we apply to it some term s, then what we do is we go into the body of the lambda term, we go into t, and we replace everything with every occurrence of x with s. And so in this talk, we will not concern ourselves with the transformations of terms. We will restrict our attention to the syntax of the lambda calculus. And so we can see some example of such syntactic terms of the lambda calculus. So first of all, we have the very well-known, combinator, where we have lambda x, x applied to x, and again, lambda x, x applied to x. And we see that if we keep beta reducing this one, it keeps reproducing itself. So the lambda calculus can have a very complicated behavior, despite its apparent simplicity. And on the second term, we see the notion of variables does not come with a restriction on the number of times they can appear. So we can have lambda x, lambda y, x applied to x applied to y. And we see here that we can use x twice. And finally, we can even discard x as in the last term. So we are discarding x, and instead we have another free variable now, which is not bound by any lambda, which is this z. So we can have free variables, we can have duplications, we can have discarding in the general lambda calculus. And so the combinatorics of the lambda calculus is what we are going to talk about. And in general, the terms of the general lambda calculus I presented before, we know that they are quite complicated, in fact. Their growth is super exponential, and the generative functions involved are not analytic for some appropriate notion of size, which is given recursively by assigning size one to variables and assigning size one plus the size of the constituent terms in the applications and the lambda term case. And so the asymptotic number of these general terms is still unresolved, the form of it. I put here a little question mark because I know Professor Olivier Bodini and Xinhui Huang, they have some results towards this direction. And so we will focus on mainly linear terms, which are restricted. They're a sub-system of the general lambda calculus. And these linear terms, they are such that the bounded variables, they must appear exactly once. So for example, lambda x, x applied to x is not linear because we have a duplication of x. While on the other hand, lambda x, lambda y, a applied to y applied to x is linear because every variable appears once. And of course, even the free variables do so. And we will also consider planar terms, which are the terms we also saw in the previous talk. And these are such that the bound variables must appear in the order they are introduced. So if we read the term from left to right, we see that lambda x, lambda y applied to x is not planar because we have this y appearing before x. While on the other hand, lambda x, lambda y, a applied to x applied to y, it is planar because red left to right, the free variables come first and then x comes and then y, exactly as they are introduced. And so the lambda calculus is very important in logic, but of course it's very interesting from the point of view of combinatorics. And so there are various connections between the lambda calculus and various combinatorial objects, like we saw before, the beta 0-1 trees. But what is important in our talk will be the connection between lambda calculus and maps. And so what are maps? They're graphs embedded in an oriented surface without boundary. So we care about not only the graph structure of the map, but also the way that around its vertex, the half edges are oriented. And so we also consider these maps up to some deformation of the underlying surface, some appropriate notion of homomorphism or ambient isotopy. And the closed linear lambda terms, they are especially combinatorially intriguing because they correspond to a very specific class of maps, which is widely studied, and it's that of rooted connected trivalent maps. And this connection was first made by Bodini, Gardin, and Jacob, and was elucidated also by a paper by Professor Noam, Zeilberger. And so we have that the subclass of linear maps, which is of linear terms, which is the planar terms, they also correspond to rooted connected planar trivalent maps. So we have this planar restriction of lambda terms corresponding to the planar restriction of the maps. And if we also allow for open terms, then we allow not only for trivalent vertices, but also some univalent ones. And we have to make a little comment here that I'm going to draw these maps by having the root being actually of degree two, but there is a very simple bijection between trivalent maps where the degree is an exception that it doesn't have a degree three, but degree two. And general trivalent maps, rooted connect trivalent maps, where everyone has a degree three. And this bijection is very simple to describe. You just essentially dissolve the vertex. So you just smooth out the vertex to just leave an edge connected to half edges. And so this connection between the lambda calculus and maps can be seen very easily in this pictorial representation I have here. So we have that half edges correspond to variables, free variables. For the case of applications, we have that if we have the application TS, then we draw the map flipped in some sense, in that we put the map which corresponds to the subterm S on the left and the map which corresponds to the subterm T on the right. And we connect the roots with the new root, which is this little vertex I have here on top. And finally, for the case of lambda terms, we have lambda x with body t being represented by a map whose gray component here is the map which corresponds to the subterm t, and where the free variable which occurs in t, the free variable x which occurs in t, is connected back to a new root whose other child is the old root of T. So this gives us a correspondence between lambda terms and maps. So we can have here an example of a term and corresponding maps. We have lambda x, lambda y applied to lambda z dot z applied to y, to x, sorry. And I have here, I have put little annotations near the vertices. I have not annotated the half edges corresponding to variables, but I have only annotated the vertices which correspond to lambda terms and abstractions. To abstractions and applications. And so we start here with lambda x. And reading the term from left to right, we see first lambda x, we see lambda y second. We see then an application whose one component is y, so one subterm is y, which is this half edge which goes off to the right. So we see here we have y on the left, but the half edge goes off to the right. It's this flipping we talked about. So we have this y going off to connect back to the lambda y. And the other subterm is lambda z, z, x. So again, we have an application. We have x on the right. So we have a half edge corresponding to x going off to the left and connecting back to the initial lambda, which corresponds to lambda x. And finally, we have lambda z, which is essentially this little loop here where the z connects back to its own lambda. And so what is the purpose of this work is to understand how typical, and by typical I mean random and of large size, linear and planar terms behave. So some natural questions to help us elucidate this this notion of how they behave is, for example, how many free variables do they have? And how often is a typical term an abstraction, or how often is it an application, which is the complement of this question? And of course, finally, it is to use and develop new tools from analytic combinatorics to obtain this some parameter distributions which will help us elucidate this question of how do these typical linear and planar terms behave. So in this talk, we'll sketch the following results. I have divided them into general categories. On the left hand, we have the linear lambda terms, which are usually differential algebraic, their equations, the equations which their generating functions satisfy. And the sequences themselves, they are divergent in the sense that the power series does not, the corresponding power series does not converge to the interior of any open disk in the complex plane. And so for this class, we will see some the limit distribution of free variables. So we'll see how the typical structure of free variables is for big linear lambda terms. We will see the limited distribution of identity subterms in closed terms. So we'll understand in typically closed linear lambda terms, how many identity subterms there exist, and we'll describe what an identity subterm is, but in fact, they correspond to just terms which look like lambda x dot x. So functions which take an argument and just return it as it is, they do nothing. So their identities. We will also see the limit distribution of closed subterms in closed terms. And finally, we will see the probability that a term is an abstraction. On the other hand, we have planar lambda terms whose generative functions satisfy algebraic equations, and the corresponding power series, they are analytic. So these are much more classical in a sense. They are much more well-behaved, and standard tools of analytic combinatorics can apply here to give us very nice results on the limit distributions. So we have here the case for limit distributions of free variables for regular and bridgeless terms, and the probability that regular or bridgeless open terms are an abstraction. And of course, this by complement gives us the probability that they are an application. So let's start with the case of free variables in closed linear terms. And this case will be a bit unorthodox. We'll see in a little bit why. So free variables, as we mentioned before, are those variables which appear in a term, but they are not bound by any abstraction. For example, here we have lambda x, ax. Here a is not bound by any lambda abstraction, so it's free. And we have that the limit distribution of free variables in linear lambda terms of size n is Gaussian with mean and variance cubic root of n. And so this cubic root of n is a bit of a strange parameter. It is not often seen. And so the general idea that the proof gets is to start with this functional equation we have here. And I mentioned that this is a bit unorthodox because this is the only case where we will not have an algebraic, differential algebraic equation, but we'll have this here equation for the exponential genetic function of the open linear lambda terms with u tied in free variables. And this comes from the definition of combinatorial maps. Combinatorial maps are a way to represent maps as systems of permutations where we have three cycles corresponding to the half edges around a vertex, fixed points here, which correspond to univalent vertices. And finally, we have involutions, which tell us how to glue half edges together. So if one sees the definition of combinatorial maps, essentially it says that the combinatorial map may be represented by a permutation and an involution, a fixed point free involution on the same set of half edges. So this is exactly the symbolic way to define this, to translate this using the symbolic method. So we have this, which corresponds to not necessarily connected maps. So we take the logarithm here to get connected maps, because we're interested in connected maps. And finally, we root them to get rooted connected trivalent maps, trivalent or one valent maps. And we have, of course, some initial conditions here. And so the proof gets is that starting from this equation, we perform a subdependent analysis on the Hadamard, the exponential Hadamard product, which appears here, which leads us to these two asymptotic results for the equations of the corresponding exponential functions, for the coefficients of the corresponding exponential functions. And finally, we are interested in translating the information about these disconnected maps into information about the connected maps. And we do this by taking the logarithm in the symbolic part. And we have a problem here because this function which appears in the interior of the composition, it is divergent. And so we have to use some, we have to use Bender's theorem, in fact, which tell us how to compose divergent power series with some convergent ones. And so by an application of Bender's theorem for r equals two, we have these following results, which tell us how to connect the asymptotics of the disconnected maps here with the asymptotics of the general connected ones. And we have to make a little change of variables to fix some periodicity issues in our genetic functions. And this finally yields the desired result. Next, we have the distribution of identity subterms in closed linear terms. So identity terms, we discussed them a bit before, but they are essentially terms which are alpha equivalent to lambda x dot x. And alpha equivalence is essentially a way of describing the process of renaming variables in such a way that it does not create any new bindings. So we say that essentially we are looking at terms which look like lambda x dot x up to appropriate renaming. And so for example, in lambda x, x, lambda y, y, you have that this little subterm here in red, the lambda y, y, it's an identity subterm. And they appear as loops in the corresponding map. We saw one example before, but here we have highlighted these two identity subterms, and we can see in the corresponding map that we have these two little loops corresponding. This one corresponds to lambda xx, and this corresponds to lambda w dot w. And so for this case, we have that the limit distribution of identity subterms in closed linear lambda terms is Poisson of parameter lambda equals one. So this is a bit perhaps surprising, because it means that if you take a huge map or a huge lambda term uniformly at random, you will not see many loops. You will just see maybe one, two, or three. And of course, it's a constant number, which is also surprising. It does not scale with the size of maps or the size of terms. And so the proof sketch here is to use moment pumping on this functional equation we have here, where G counts closed linear terms with U tagging identity subterms. In this case, we have an ordinary genetic function, not as before where we had an exponential one. And so let us start by giving a bit of a justification for this functional equation. So we have that this functional equation essentially tells us that terms are either identity terms, which is this case here, we have a Z squared. We have a little correction we will not cross ourselves with, but it's a net case. So it tells us that a term is either an identity term, so it is either of the form lambda x dot x, or it is an application, or finally it is a lambda term which is formed equivalently by either considering as a lambda term as we described before, or by considering it as a term which is this body term here t, where we have a little loop which we have pointed at. And so the bijection between these two versions that lambdas correspond to pointed loops is that this pointed loop, we can essentially, we can cut it open and glue it up into a new root. So this correspondence is invertible, and it tells us essentially that lambda terms are the same thing as taking a body term and finding some loop in it and tagging it. And so from this differential equation, we may start pumping moments to find the moments of the corresponding limit distribution. And in general, we can see that the kth derivative of this equation may be written in this form, where we have the kth derivative of g minus some term which here is of this form and depends on the parity of k, minus two times this product between g, and the kth derivative of g equals the kth plus one derivative of g. And essentially the idea is that here, this s and this 2zg kth derivative of g do not contribute asymptotically. And this is because of the factorial growth of these coefficients. And so essentially, because here we have always a multiplication by z, we have a shift in the coefficients. And because they grow factorially, if essentially we have that the coefficient gn is, the coefficient gn in minus one is dominated asymptotically by the coefficient of gn, and so it may be neglected asymptotically. And so in the end, we have that the kth, the coefficient of the kth derivative equals the coefficient of the kth plus one derivative of g, and so we get a Poisson distribution. And the next distribution we'll talk about is the distribution of closed subterms in closed linear terms. So closed subterms are a bit, they include the previous case, but they are a bit more complicated. And this is a work in progress, so I will not talk about it a lot. And I will not give much of a justification for it, but I have it here for the sake of letting people know that the result I will show in a bit. So closed subterms, they are subterms which have no free variables. And in the map world, they correspond to bridges. So we have here the term lambda x, x, lambda y, y, lambda z, z. And we see here that this little subterm, it contains no free variables if we consider it as a subterm of the biggest term, of the bigger term. And of course, it corresponds to this little grayed out component here, which if we cut this bridge here, it becomes a true connected component with which does not contain the root. So the larger context here, lambda x, x, and the application become the outer connect component, and the inner one is corresponds to this subterm. And so we have this correspondence between bridges and closed subterms in these terms. And again, we have the result which shows that the limit distribution of these closed subterms in closed linear lambda terms is Poisson of parameter lambda equals one. And so the idea is to use the moment pumping again, this time on a much more complicated differential equation we have here, where W counts closed linear terms with V tagging identity subterms. So again, this is a bit of a work in progress, so I cannot go much into it, but the idea is that here, this combinatorial corresponds to a decomposition of terms by considering again some cases of the form identity or application or lambda. And in this case, the lambda is not a real nice bijection like the previous case, but it's a bit more complicated. And on the other hand, for the moment pumping process, we have again the same idea that we find a general form for the kth derivative, but it's a bit more tricky to localize the main contributions. Now, finally, we have for the case of closed linear lambda terms, the probability that asymptotically such a term is an abstraction. And so we have asymptotically almost surely that such a random closed linear lambda term is an abstraction. And the idea here is very simple. It follows directly from the factorial growth of the the closed linear lambda terms. And essentially the idea is that we compare the coefficient of L and 2z to the 4 derivative with respect to z of L, which corresponds to the case of lambda terms. So this corresponds to the case again of identities, this corresponds to the case of abstraction, and this corresponds to the case of this is the case of applications, and this is the case of applications. And so we can compare in this equation the case of applications with the general case. And by taking the appropriate quotient, we find that asymptotically these terms are always an abstraction. Finally, we turn to the realm of planar terms. We can give a bit of a justification for this equation. I already did. But the idea is again that we have that a lambda term is either a identity term, or it is an application, or finally it's a lambda. And how do you form a lambda? You take a map, you pick some vertex. So we have this pointing here. So you pick some vertex and you choose the edge above it to split it by introducing a new vertex here in an application. And one of the half edges which goes off the application can either go off to the left or the right. So we have these two here. And this goes back up and connects to a new vertex which becomes the root of the whole map. And this gives us exactly this term and exactly a way to form lambda terms for closed linear terms. And so finally, we turn to the realm of planar terms. And here we have a distribution of free variables in planar and bridgeless planar terms. So we see here a very different behavior for the case of planar and bridgeless planar terms. We have that the limit distribution of free variables in planar terms is Gaussian with mean n over 8 and variance 9 n over 32. So they are linear in the size n. And the same is true for the bridgeless planar terms, where we have a mean of n over 5 and a variance of 9 n over 25. So perhaps I didn't mention what the bridgeless planar term is, but it's the name is very descriptive. It's essentially planar terms which have no closed subterms, so no bridges. And so this both the proof sketch here is that both results follow similar steps. And the idea is to start with these two equations. Because of time limits, I cannot go much into it. But the idea is again that a planar bridgeless planar term is either a free variable or an application, or they are lambdas. And here we have to take some care to have, for example, here in the planar case, we have to choose a term which has at least one free variable, which we're gonna abstract over. And here we can note that we have no derivation, we have no derivatives, because essentially when you make a planar term, you have no choice as to where to create your next lambda. You have to pick the appropriate free variable, which does not create any crossings, right? And so this leads us from the realm of differential equations to the realm of plain algebraic equations. And here we have again u-tiding free variables. And the idea is that we can use elimination and quadratic method here on these two equations to obtain a closed form solution for P and Q. And finally, we can proceed by applying some standard theorems from, say, Flazzolet and Sedgwick on the perturbation of algebraic singularity schemas, etc. So we can see here that the closed form solutions, they are not very pretty. So this is for the bridgeless planar terms. And here's the one for the general planar terms. So they exist, they are here, but they are not very pretty and they are not very illuminating. And in fact, here it would be interesting if, so we have by elimination or by the quadratic method, we can in fact find a closed form for this PZ0 and this U1 coefficient of QZU, but it would be very interesting if we also find some functional equations, because this will allow us to also, for example, here talk about closed planar terms, which we do not talk about in this talk. And so we also have the probability that an open planar or bridgeless planar term is an abstraction. And here again, this follows plainly from the analyticity of these generating functions. So the idea is again to estimate the case of the abstraction and compare its coefficients with the case of the general terms. And so we have here this corresponds to the number of its degenerate function for the lambda abstractions, for the planar in the bridgeless planar case, and here in the denominator we have the general case of all planar terms and all bridgeless planar terms. And so since these functions, they are very nicely behaved, we have that the closed planar terms and the U1 coefficient, so bridgeless planar terms with one free variable, they are both analytic at the respective singularities of the general generative functions P and Q. And so since we have the closed forms for both P, Q, and we know that the other two are analytic, we can replace everything with either a singular expansion or a Taylor expansion at the corresponding singularities and obtain the desired result. So we got essentially that these guys do not contribute, and we have the ZP, Z1 over PZ1 and ZQ, Z1 over QZ1. And so this leads to the fact that the probability that the random open planar or bridgeless planar term is an abstraction equals its radius of convergence of the corresponding generative function. So to conclude, we have clear distinctions between the divergent and the differentially algebraic case of linear random terms. And on the other hand, we have the well-behaved algebraic one of planar terms. So it's very interesting to note that there is this, essentially these are two realms in the in our study, which require very different tools to handle. And so we have a need for, on the one hand, more tools to handle divergent combinatorial classes. So theorems like the theorem by Bender I showed you earlier, or some theorems to help us, for example, linearize some of these differential equations I presented, because some of them are, of course, Riccati. And on the other hand, it would be very interesting, as I mentioned, to have some algebraicity results for closed planar terms, which will allow us to find some equivalent parameters as we did for the closed linear random terms. So for example, distributions of bridges and loops. And of course, for future directions, it would be very nice to study also the dynamics of the lambda calculus, so the notion of beta reduction. And finally, of course, a very important part of the lambda calculus, which is the typing of it. So the linearly typed lambda calculus, its connection to logic, etc. And that's pretty much it. Thank you.
Thank you, Alex, very much. Thank you, very nice. So we have time for some questions. Are there any questions? So far, there were no questions in the chat.
Rick Stanton here. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we hear you well.
Yeah, I want to know what the obstacles to extending the result to say linear terms embeddable in the torus. I wanted to genus one. If with only one handle, you could perhaps get a nice embedding that allows you to do surgery and reduce it to the planar case. I wonder if you'd explore that and how difficult it might be.
So I didn't hear the class.
Pardon?
The class of the terms you mentioned. So you said, what is the difficulty of extending our results to what class?
The class of those, linear terms embeddable in the torus, genus one.
So in our case, we do not have any restriction on the genus. In the case of the general linear lambda term, so when we consider linear lambda terms, they are regardless of genus, so we have crossings. On the other hand, we have the case of planar terms which are embedded in the sphere. And so you're asking in between if we can have some information about the classes which are specifically embedded, like of genus one or something.
Yes.
I have not tried this. I don't know if it's what it corresponds to in the realm of lambda terms. I guess you allow for a limited number of crossings. That's a very
I'm suggesting the following. Mm-hmm. If you can do surgery on a single handle and reduce it from the torus, the genus one to genus zero, you may be able to do an inductive argument and do all genuses.
I see. Yeah, that's a very interesting question. I have not studied it. Perhaps Professor Noam knows more about it.
Thank you.
You know, just to say, I mean, yeah, I think it's interesting. These kinds of questions have been studied in the realm of map combinatorics. I mean, this is something that Alain Giorgetti has looked at from the map combinatorics side. And so it could be interesting to try to to do some of these analyses for lambda calculus parameters for restricted genus terms. Yeah, but that's all. I think it's an interesting question.
It also would be interesting to see where the difference pops out first time, because we see that we have this essentially like a phase transition between the general case of the linear terms and the planar case. So it would be interesting if it already breaks up for the torus, or it happens more gradually as you increase your genus. You go from the Gaussian, the linear Gaussian distribution for free variables, for example, to the one for the cubic root on the general linear terms, etc.
Yeah, I confirm, it's a good question.
I don't know a lot about lambda terms, but if everything on planar maps applies, then probably if we are on limited, so bounded genus, then the results asymptotics will be roughly the same, except perhaps some polynomial factor, something like that. Probably not even that. But then we will probably see a phase transition when we go from zero, so is zero and fixed genus, to the arbitrary general case. There would be a phase transition somewhere, but it's still very, very unknown to even the in the map community. So it's something very interesting to explore, I think.
May I ask small question?
Mm-hmm.
On your slide 4, you show the bijection between maps, and you have an application ST, and then you swap the T on the S for the map. Is there a deep reason for this, or just?
So I think it's just a convention of how to draw it, because you could as well decide that applications they go the other way. And the another like ad hoc conversion was that I always was putting the half edge, which corresponds to the variable of a lambda term, going off to the left. I might as well have put it on the right, and this would essentially mirror the images you saw. So I don't know if it's perhaps I'm wrong, but I think it's just a convention, right, of how you decide to interpret the lambda term as a map.
I think so, but I would like a confirmation.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
So I think even in some papers, the conventions are a bit different. So I think between the paper of Professor Noam and the paper of Professor Olivier, maybe there are some differences in how the half edges go and how the subterms of the applications go. Yes. I'm not sure, I have not looked at it in a long time, but yeah.
Okay.
Okay, any other questions? Perfect, doesn't seem the case. So thank you, Alex, again, for your very nice and interesting talks. The other questions we postpone, or if there are any, to the Discord channel. So I encourage you to